the hurricane.
The wind, that unpredictable, unseen element, which at times can be relaxed and gentle, and at others powerful and destructive. Its power is utilized in various ways to serve man's needs. Recreations. Youthful pleasures. One of man's earliest labor-saving devices to harness this power was the windmill. And throughout the English countryside, the traveler may see a few examples of this once so common and accepted part of the landscape. There are possibly as many as 10,000 windmill sites in the country. Many mills were used for grinding corn to produce flour for bread and feed for animals of the farm. On the Norfolk Broads and in the Fen Country, large numbers of mills were built to drain the land, by pumping water into the dikes and rivers so that it could flow away to sea. These graceful structures, which have inspired artists and poets over the years, once played an important part in the life of the community. Most of them have now outlived their usefulness in this modern world, although one or two may still be found at work, proud survivors of a bygone age. Around the country, a number of other fine examples remain to be seen and admired, windmills which have been restored by individuals and local authorities. For some, time, and the worst of the English weather, has taken its toll and left the derelict remains of a once proud mill. Like gaunt sentinels of a past age, they stand, their derelict machinery lying rusted and forlorn, with lifeless, silent arms still pointing to the open sky. Even those in decay can still be appreciated as things of beauty by the keen admirer, and can provide a good subject for the painter and photographer. The earliest type are known as postmills, a wooden-framed rectangular construction which houses all the machinery. The whole building is supported on a massive upright post, with the weight taken on two horizontal cross trees below via four sloping quarter bars. The lower part of the mill is often enclosed by a roundhouse, which protects the supporting timber from the weather and provides a store for grain. A tail pole projecting at the rear, and sometimes supported at the end by a cartwheel running on a track, enabled the miller to turn the whole body of the mill to face the wind. Early sails were wooden frameworks carefully weathered or twisted like a propeller. Over these, the miller set and reefed canvas sailcloths to catch the wind. At Bourne in Cambridgeshire and Pitstone in Buckinghamshire are to be found the oldest surviving post mills in the country, both dating from the 1600s. Here at Pitstone, the wooden sails are replaced after a periodic overhaul. Work carried out by enthusiastic volunteers in not the best of English weather. Job well done, and a credit to all concerned. Of a later design is the smock mill, usually an eight-sided wooden construction, some quite large, like this one at Upminster in Essex. The sails and a fantail fit on a revolving cap, rotating on a level curb on top of the mill body. The wind, striking the blades of the fantail, causes the cap to revolve through a system of gearing until the sails face into the wind. The full power of the wind is thus obtained to drive the mill machinery. This elegant smock mill at Cranbrook in Kent is one of the finest in the country, rising to a height of 72 feet. The pinnacle of windmill design, the tower mill. These were usually constructed of brick or stone, and protected from the elements by a good coat of tar, which lasts for many years. Some of the finest were built in the early part of the 19th century, and due to the builder's skill and excellent workmanship, many towers remain to this day. Tower mills, like smock mills, use the revolving cap principle, controlled by a fantail to keep the sails into the wind. Many types of cap were introduced, but they were all designed to overcome the main problem of keeping the mill and all its machinery protected from the elements. Most mills are fitted with four sails, although some have five, six, or even eight. Although most of them are now disused and derelict, a few, like this tall drainage mill at Burney Arms near Great Yarmouth, are restored to almost perfect working order. This mill, under the care of the Department of the Environment, is open to the public between May and October each year. It can only be reached by train or by boat on the adjoining Braden Water. Here, under the cap, one may stand and listen to the song of the wind outside, a sound which travels far and wide across the Broads. By the end of the 18th century, mills were being equipped with a new type of sail consisting of a series of hinged shutters, like a Venetian blind. With the mill at rest, the miller, by tensioning a spring at the tip of each sail, opens or closes the shutters according to the state of the wind, and so regulates the speed of the sails. A later design, known as patent sails, has remote control for use while the sails are turning, worked by varying the mass of weight suspended on a chain outside the mill. In the heart of the mill, the wind's power transferred from the sweeping sails outside to the intricate gear wheels, belts and pulleys drives the massive grinding stones. A governor controls the important gap between the stones, which determines the consistency of the flour produced. Corn is fed to the stones from a bin on a higher floor, connected by chutes to the hoppers. The sacks of grain are hauled up by the hoist through trap doors on each floor and then fed into the bin by the miller. An ingenious warning bell system is used to inform the miller when the hoppers are running empty. He also has to check the sacks of meal and ground flour at the end of its downward journey. This tower mill at North Laverton near Retford is one of the two remaining in commercial use. It is still worked regularly to serve local farmers' needs. Its dedicated miller, a real craftsman of his trade. There is always a warm welcome here for visitors who wish to look over the mill and learn how the power of the wind is harnessed for the use of man. Another mill that can still be seen at work is at Pakenham, near Bury St. Edmunds in Suffolk. Throughout the country, other mills are open to the public from time to time for those who wish to discover for themselves the charm and fascination of these survivors of a bygone age. On a day's tour, members of the Wind and Water Mill section of the Society for the Protection of Ancient Buildings visit the smock mills at Mepham and Cranbrook in Kent. One of the main objects of this section of the Society is to stimulate the interest of the public in the preservation of wind and water mills as features of the countryside. It also offers advice to local authorities and individuals in restoring and repairing mills and encourages the craft of country milling. On another occasion, members visit Billingford Tower Mill near Diss in Norfolk. One of the country's finest preserved post mills is at Saxted Green, near Framlingham in Suffolk. Under the care of the Department of the Environment, it is open regularly to visitors between spring and autumn each year. Preserved by the Beverley Council in North Humberside, this tall tower mill overlooks the cornfields at Skidby, 6 miles northwest of Hull. A long restoration program aims to bring back into working order the tallest tower mill in the country, Sutton Corn Mill, near Hickling Broad in Norfolk, built in 1789. Herringfleet Smock Mill, on the bank of the River Waveney, is turned by a tailpole and winch to face the sails into the wind. Maintained by the Suffolk County Council, this marsh mill is operated occasionally for visiting parties, when conditions allow. Other mills are in the process of being repaired and restored. The country's oldest surviving smock mill at Lacey Green in Buckinghamshire. In the same county, members of a local society work at weekends on the tower mill, which overlooks the village green at Quainton. Here, volunteers are engaging their various skills on this fine post mill at Ramsey in Essex. In his famous Rural Rides around England in 1830, William Cobbett recorded from Suffolk, "The numerous windmills on the hills, turning their arms against the sky, with the broad and beautiful arm of the sea on one hand, and the fields, meadows, and farmhouses on the other, appeared to make the most beautiful sight I had ever beheld." Today, any windmill turning its sails against the summer sky is still one of the most beautiful sights in the English landscape. North Laverton Mill stands in the shadow of the great power station across the fields, creating a rather different skyline to that in William Cobbett's day. To help meet Britain's ever-increasing demand for energy, the basic principles of the original windmills are now being used in the design of wind-powered generators. Perhaps in the future, a new type of windmill will be found on our coastlines and hilltops, and another traveller will record the scene. Windmills are part of our inheritance. Only we can help to prevent these graceful reminders of the past from disappearing forever from the Norfolk Broads and the cornfields of England. With public support to appeals, more mills may yet be repaired and restored, so that their sails may once again turn to the wind.